Welcome to the stage, the sweetheart of Christian contemporary music, LadyZee Bankhead. Put your hands together for the sweetest lady I know.
I just keep on asking you who.
West Michigan Has Gospel 2 show is brought to you by Elder Beerman, elegant, authentic, and sophisticated. Dillard, the style of your life. Elk, the modern Southern style. And Tiffany and Company, of New York City since 1837.
For tuning in and watching the show, please don't forget to sponsor. Please don't forget to subscribe to this channel so you can be the first to know when new episodes are coming out. Mother Rybi Jessie Kova is going to tell us what happened at the funeral she sung at for the celebrity who passed away. And just listen to the story, try not to be judgmental, and see it from her point of view. I know this show, it seems like she was going on and on, but You have to be respectful. You don't want to stop the train of thought once an elderly person has started, because that could basically interfere with what they're trying to say. So it's not that I'm a bad host or anything. It's just that I'm very respectful to my elders. And I like to encourage that all over the world, to remember the elders and be nice and kind and gentle to your elders, because they're the ones that holding our future in their hands. If we do not get the wisdom that they have for us, we're going to be lost. I'm going to let her roam free and tell us exactly what happened at the funeral, what did she sing, what did she say that upset so many people. And I want you to be respectful and attentively listen to her story to see her point of view. Because sometimes when we prejudge, we get it wrong. So let's just see why people was upset and see if there was basically any reason. And keep in mind, sometime at funerals, we're already upset. So it doesn't matter what happens, we'll always be upset. So with that being said, we're going to let Mother Rabbi Jessie Kova tell her story uninterrupted so we can get the full aspect of what happened at that celebrity's funeral that she sung at that made people so upset. Then Mother Rabbi Jessie Kova is going to sing Death Bond. That's the song that caused so much controversy at the funeral. So she's going to come and she's going to tell the story. Then she's going to sing Death Bond, that song she sung at the celebrity's funeral, the one she wrote just for that funeral. And Mother Rabbi Jessie Kova also is going to give us some pearls of wisdom, some advice about how to get through this life, how to accept rejection, what to do after you receive rejection, and how much weight should you give another person's opinion about what you say or what you do or some wrong that you've done. So she's going to give us some advice regarding those issues. And I myself, I'm going to listen attentively as well, because I think she is a very wise woman. And we need a lot of wisdom to get through this life. Thank you for watching the show. And the next voice you will hear will be Rabbi Jessie Kova.
I was asked last month to sing at a celebrity funeral, and I went to the lady that, I'm not going to mention who the celebrity was, but I went there to the funeral by a request of the deceased and the deceased's family, and it was quite a spirited funeral. I mean, people was hopping and running out the doors and then, you know, trying to open up the windows and, you know, let some of that stuff out. I was hot, 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 hot. And they had to let that alcohol out. But we went a little bit over the time. It's supposed to have been 2 hours. It ended up being about 3 hours. But, you know, once that wheel get turning, who am I to stop the wheel from rolling through? Well, rumors have it that I ruined the film. But I merely told the truth. Truth. Truth is hard to find these things. I just merely told the truth. The place was packed. We were in the Coliseum, and the place was packed from top to bottom. You had all kinds of family members from all over, and had people from all over, and celebrities alike from all over, journalists, reporters, and videographers. They were all there. And I must say that I thought I was the most important celebrity there, because they wouldn't take the cameras and wouldn't stop clicking. That's how I knew truth. That freedom ring. Yes, indeed. I let that truth ring all through that place and went rolling through battle and rolled all over those people. Yes, it did. And I wasn't ashamed of it, because the deceased knew me. He knew what I would do. He expected me to do so, and that was his only request for his funeral, was to have me there speaking and singing. And that's what I did, and the family requested it as well, some of the people in the family. So I couldn't disappoint nobody, so I went there with no other reason but to do my job, you know. And I don't work for men. I work for, you know, the higher power. I work for the higher power, and a lot of times that's going to conflict with me. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And I can't help it if the truth took the show. I wasn't there telling no lies. Lies! And a person's last day on earth, you got to get up there and lie. Can you believe it? Not me. These lies tell them while standing in God's house on the altar. Oh, no! No, no, honey. You got the wrong mother to do that. I'm Mother Rybi Jessie Kova. I don't do no lying on the altar. Or no place else. If you want the truth, truth is what you're going to get. If you don't want no truth, then call somebody else. That's all I'm saying. I know somebody, a missionary, that, you know, that tells some lies. I'll talk about that a little bit later on the show, but I hope I get a chance to talk to missionary Titler, because she and I got some business to take care of. I know that. Mm-hmm. Some people say they were upset, but I didn't see nothing to be upset about. I did what I was asked to do, what I was expected to do. They know how I am. I'm not in there. What's wrong with the world is people get in these funerals and start lying, you know. Well, I'm not going to be lying right up there on the altar. Are you kidding me? In God's house, you expect me to lie down. I'm not going to tell no lies. I'm not built that way, you know. If the person was a real stick in the mud, I think you should say, hey, the man was a stick in the mud, but beloved, you know, just true stuff, you know. People don't want you to say nothing. If daddy and papa was a rolling stone, you should have said that stone kept rolling until the day he died. Watch out. That stone didn't roll over to my house. You ought to just tell the truth, you know what I'm saying? That's what y'all tell you, just tell the truth. Just rolled all over people, all over things. Just truth, truth, truth. Good enough. Just gas. And hard. People look in their ears and eyes popping out. But I kept on telling the truth because it was just the truth. And if anybody can tell the truth, it would be me. After 87 years, you know, I should be able to tell the truth and stand on it and live with it. And that's what I'm doing, you know. I've been noticing for quite some time that even in church, some people don't want to tell the truth even in church. Some people get up with a testimony, the next one get up and sound just like that testimony before. People get in these cliques, and they can't tell the truth. They start pretending. Nobody's being delivered. Just pretending all the time. Well, there's too much lying going on in the church. If you're broke, you're just broke. Can't give an exception. Can't give a preacher all your money. Just that simple. Preachers won't preach the truth about this money either. They're supposed to have all the money. What's supposed to be going on? The Lord told us not to give that up necessity, meaning I don't want your bill money. 10% don't come off your bill money. It comes off the money you have left over. He don't want to mess with your household. He promised a roof over your head and food and raiment. He don't want that money. The money he's talking about is the excess money after those bills are paid. You know what I'm saying? And any other overage that you acquire, like bonuses and stuff like that. Now, if you put in some collection and your lights off, you're sinning. If you put in collection, can't buy your kids from school clothes, you're sinning. If you put in collection and the preacher is a dick, you sin it. You don't supposed to be giving into no dead thing. And I'm not trying to curse up in here, you know, Jane and Dick and Jay. But you don't supposed to be giving to no preacher like that from Jeff Street. So your money gonna be blowed on according to the word of God. Your money's gone. There'll be no profit in giving into a dead thing. I'm not against giving. But there are a lot of agendas in church that had nothing to do with Jesus Christ. Anyway, back to this here. I don't mean to be coming in here taking no topics and subjects here, but you know, some things will just rub me wrong, and I just got fed up about it. Don't be coming up in the new church and giving your bill money away, just so you look like you got big money. Don't give your bill money away. Put your bill money on your bills. And then the Lord will increase so you can put some more money into his house. That's how that works. You have a roof, he has a roof. But if you don't have no roof, you're going to come and pull up on this roof. And maybe nobody have a roof after that. You got to just do what you're supposed to be doing, and that's all you're supposed to be doing. That's it. At the funeral services, pre religious Christians and audience alike. Just didn't want to hear the truth. That's what happened. That's what they all upset about, the truth. I don't know what happened, but the truth came rolling out of my mouth and rolled all over. I didn't apologize for it because it's just the truth. And it just knocked down the whole church just about like, ooh, you can hear a pin drop when I got bit. But that's how that spirit is. Come on in and swipe your mouth shut and let some knowledge come in. That's what it was all about. That's all. That was my job, you know. And the deceased knew me very well. We have been friends for the last, 30, 40 years. He knew that I would come in there and set the record straight, and that's what I did. So what happened was, I told a story, an experience that I had experienced with the deceased 7 days before his death. I went over there to visit the deceased. And the deceased seemed to be pretty high, I'll say. He was on some crank or something. I don't know what name stuff name called, but pretty powerful stuff. I could tell he was kind of phony at the mouth, and words weren't quite clear, you know. Now, I don't know if you ever seen people that's so high. Starts turning on stoves and cleaning gums and stuff. You just get nervous because you don't know what's gonna happen. And he began to cook. He put a skillet on the stove, got some meat out of the refrigerator, poured some, looked like some Crisco in that skillet, and threw the meat into the skillet. And in about a minute or so, I started hearing all kinds of screeching going on. I'm thinking, where's that screeching coming from? This screeching, it was messing with my ears. And I'm thinking, what is that screeching? What is that noise? And I also couldn't rightfully recognize the smell. I don't know what he was cooking. And I'm a pretty good cook myself, and I couldn't put my finger on it. And the screeches got louder and louder. I looked up thinking, what the devil is that? What is that sound? I didn't know what was going on. You got the screeching, strange smell, and Larry just stirring it up in the pan, getting some salt and pepper, seasoning it all up and thinking, am I crazy? Am I high or something? Have I taken something, some weeds or something? I don't know nothing about it. Have I got a contact? I didn't know what was going on. I didn't know what was going on. I got very scared and nervous. You know, when it takes a lot to get off, my nerves all wrapped up. And I was all wrapped up. I began to sweat and, water running off and underneath my braces. And I didn't know what was going on. I got up to look to see what Larry was cooking. And, mercy! Mercy me! Mercy! It was red scrambling around in that thing trying to get out! It was scrambling around in the pan trying to get out of that pan. And it was trying to stand out and stand up and it was freezing and running. I was shipping to the core. I don't know. know why I told the story, but it was obvious that, let them know where it's obvious, that the story should be told. I was so concerned about the deceased. So I sat that down to the table and I asked the deceased, what is that squeaking sound? You know what he said? He said that was a ceiling fan that he needed to put some WD-40 on. And I said, what? My eyes got big as a saucer. I'm thinking, what? A ceiling fan? Are you kidding me? So I sat there because I was too afraid to leave. I was just shaking my knees. Like, shake, shake, shake. And it was shaking all over, you know. I'm grabbing myself like this. Am I alive? Am I alive? You stoned out your mind. And I'm stone crazy from being here, you know. And Larry took out a plate. I keep saying that, I'm sorry. The deceased took out a plate and began to pour those rats on the plate who had now just musing in their own blood gravy. He stopped and looks at me. Would you like to have some, he said. I said, no, not at this time. Perhaps another time, because I didn't want to excite him, you know. So he poured that whole skillet of fried rats on the plate, got him a piece of white bread, start sopping up the blood gravy, and said, oh, my. I'm thinking, you don't know what you're missing. Can you believe it?
From the deceased family. And he sent in this quote. Mrs. Kova's song reminded me of the mercies of God. And I thought that it would endure forever. Would you care to comment on this statement?
Many members, especially in the family, didn't even want me to stop singing the song, you know. They were very supportive during the song. And when I knew I was singing at a funeral, and I knew there was a time restriction, but they were very supportive. I can tell how they kept clapping after every sentence that they wanted me to keep going, you know. All of a sudden, like if I sang, "The old rugged prof," they start clapping. Yeah, I stood at their feet, they would clap even harder after every sentence. They just kept on clapping. And I knew I was at on a time restraint, as it being a funeral, and I didn't want to take up all the time, but with that kind of feedback, it lets you know that it's a song that people want to hear. And, I wasn't going to stop until I kind of died down and people, you know, the soul was soothed, you know, and stuff like that. So that's what happened in Dalrock. And some of them came up to me after the funeral and said, one of them said, "Your singing was so divine. It reminded me of the peace of God." That really warmed me inside. That warmed me inside.
But didn't they also say that your singing surpassed all understanding?
It surpassed all understanding. Oh, girl! Tears would roll down my eyes because I knew that was it. That was my confirmation. It was a divine. It reminded them of a piece of God. It just surpassed all understanding. That's what that song did to people, you know. I know I'm a good singer. You know, I knew I touched somebody because I felt it too powerful, powerful, powerful. And I knew I had touched somebody. And yeah, I tore that place up. Yes, I did. Tore that place up. Yes, but those particular family members was, they was kind of reminded me of Swiss cheese, you know. As soon as the knowledge come in, it rolls right out of those holes. So I wasn't really concerned about that because they couldn't have an accurate thought even if they had a surrogate thinker, you know. So they wouldn't get a thought right even if somebody else was doing the thinking. So I didn't let that didn't bother me none. No, honey, that didn't bother me none because I know I had some. Yeah, I let that all out. I'm gonna sing something today, you know, because people need to understand, you know, about what's going on in life. Mm-hmm. Now, I don't think about much about that when it comes to negativity because I have a job to do, you know. That's I'm focused. You gotta stay focused. You know what I'm saying? I'm focused. And that's what I am. I'm focused. And it's going to be some hard time trying to convince people to stay focused, stay focused, stay focused. You got to learn where the adversary sits. And you got to beam that higher power towards that spirit and knock him out or her out or it out. You got to do it. Let your little light shine, girl. That's all I'm talking about. Let it shine, let it shine, let it shine.
Mm-hmm. We had the opportunity to speak with a couple of journalists. We spoke with who covered the funeral for the celebrity deceased. And here's a quote from Roy Koch from the New York Times. He says, "Rybi Jessie Kova delivered each song with the delicacy of a sonic boom." Now that's loud. That's very loud. Would you care to comment on that statement?
Yes. I've been meaning to tell Mr. Koch. Mr. Koch, thank you. Thank you for increasing my sales and publicity. I couldn't have done it without you. And the royalty checks are starting to look real good. That's what I want to tell Mr. Cox, that you're a great journalist. To keep up the good word, Mr. Cox. And I tell you, that's when you think you can't sell no more records. All those new people turn that around for you. And if it's bad news, you good news, you know, put you back in the spotlight. And that's what I should do. Back in the spotlight, that's what Mr. Cox did. Thank you, Mr. Cox. Thank you, Mr. Cox. Thank you, Mr. Cox. That's all I have to say to Mr. Cox. Just thank you, thank you, thank you.
Tom from the Washington Post sent in this quote. He said, the only thing that pays better than having no taste is having no shame. Would you care to comment on that, Steve, please?
Oh, Tom. I've had run-ins with Tom from the Washington Post before. Mr. Tom from the Times. Unfortunately, he's not that good of a journalist. He's the type of journalist that smells flowers and immediately think of a funeral. He will immediately negate good to bad, bad to good, every time. And he wished he was Mr. Cox. But Mr. Tom is just Mr. Tom. We all know what Uncle Tom's are. I don't need to go down that road, won't you? I tell you that. Yeah, one can always find a little bad and a big lump of good, you know. That's just the way it is, you know. Let's pick at it, you know. All this politically correct stuff and talking about we're in a land of free and do you want to say something politically. What is politics anyway, those lying thieves? We got to start lying like them or what? Why would we want to be politically correct when there's nothing politically correct about the politicians that's performing in the political arena? Let's not get carried away. Say what you got to say. Have something to back it up, an experience or something. That's all I'm saying. Say it. Oh, politically correct. Some people apologize for telling the truth. Why? Why would you apologize for telling the truth? Truth just truth. I'll tell you this. I'm not going to apologize for telling the truth. Truth stands alone, whether I say it or not. Whether I say it or not, it stands alone. When I'm dead and gone, truth will be standing. Mm-hmm. Some people go out and say, you know, that was a really good cherry pie. But couldn't she have gotten all the cherries the same size? You'll always get people complaining about something good. Even when they're happy, they're sad. They got to pull out some kind of sadness out of the happiness. Yeah. I am not thinking about none of that stuff. No. Nope. No, not me.
Another rabbi, I am very concerned in regards to the plethora of negativity that seems to surround your singing career. As a singer myself, you get a lot of feedback. And depending on how strong you are in the Lord, or in something that you believe in. For me, it's the Lord. How do you let that roll off your back? Advise the singers and other people that has experienced a horrible situation of negativity where they have done something that is considered unpolitical. Please share with us how you handle this situation of negativity. And it seems like I'm looking at the number of emails now totaling as of today around a little over 6,000 negative emails that you received. That's a lot of email. I'm concerned about your emotional status regarding all of this negativity. How are you coping with this type of negativity?
You know, I look at situations like this. There's just one moment in time. Just one moment. This time will pass. It will be old news. No matter what experience you're in right now. And I'm in my teacher's voice right now because I really want you to understand that you're gonna have some bad times. You're gonna make mistakes. You're gonna do some bad things that time. That's just one moment in time. It's not going to erase all the good you've done. That doesn't mean that you are bad. Sorry. doesn't mean that you are that sorry. Doesn't mean that you are that person because you did that thing. It's just one moment in time. It doesn't define your whole entire life. If you make a mistake or make a bad decision or get a bad situation, that's just one moment in time. I'm not going to take the rest of my life being dug into that little hole when there's a big hole over here of success. What am I supposed to do with all that success and joy? Throw it away? I don't think so. I'm going to keep on and hold on to that big lump of success up forever. And I'm not going to be defined to this one funeral I sung at because I sung at many. It was just the fact that this was a celebrity and the celebrity, you know, was well known, which made my singing well known because of that. But that's still one moment in my life. Some liked it, some didn't. And we move on from there. You got to, you know, have the right shoe on and the left shoe. That makes a pair of shoes. And that's what life is, good and bad. Don't try to have so much good and not enough bad. Let's just even it out. Because by right, our days are short and full of trouble. And stop trying to look for worlds that doesn't have trouble. We ain't already told you what we're going to have. Things happen all the time. It makes you a better person at times. Don't worry about it. Negative plus positive equals living. Without both, you can't appreciate either. Just remember, Mother Rybi Jessie Kova said, one plus one doesn't always equal two. It means one. Just one united into the entity of itself, the oneness of it. Keep that in mind. Good days, some say outweigh bad days. Sometimes it doesn't happen that way. Sometimes people say, you know, it's been nothing but sunshine since I've been saved. Well, I ain't had that time yet. I had some sunshine, but I mean, I've had a lot of rain, a lot of storms, a lot of hurricanes, and some tsunamis as well. And you know, it hasn't been easy. And Ecclesiastes, it tells us that, you know, a man that's born of a woman, which I was. I don't know what everybody else was trying to make babies these days, but man born of a woman is given a few days, and those few days are going to be full of trouble. My life has been full of trouble. There's no such thing since I met Jesus. Yes, everything has changed because you're a new creature now. You think differently about it. You know that if the Lord does not deliver, he can. And if he doesn't, he wouldn't put no more on you than you can bear. So that gives you that joy, that springboard to spring above that stuff and do what you need to do. That's what happens. Not like we got, you know, rain and gold or anything. But we're filled with that thing that makes us an overcomer. That's what we are. Overcomers. Not deep, but overcomers. All you have to do is get over it, folks. And they will too. They'll only hang on to it as long as it's bothering you. It's not bothering me. They say, oh, Mother Rabbi looks terrible. So what? So I look terrible. Move on. And get over it. Mother Rabbi is all right. Mother Rabbi can pay her bills and stuff like that, you know. Mother Rabbi can get that Bible and read it and get some joy, you know. In life, but really, the only thing that's going to last is that living stuff that you get out of the world. You know, the world cleans you and gives you joy, you know, strength, and, I better get off that subject right now, girl, because you know I get to go on with that word, because that word is power. It makes you feel like superwoman. It makes you feel like you can leave, you know, tall buildings in the same fire. Why? Because you are in him, he's in you. Woo! 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 Oh! 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 Give me a minute. But in the end, just being truthful with you right now. In the end, it wasn't the words that my enemy spoke. It was the silence of my friends that hurt me. People that supposed to be able to testify of you, knowing that you wouldn't try to do nothing to hurt anyone but to help people. And in order to help people, sometimes you gotta be a rough rider. Everybody can't be sweet. Somebody gotta say something bitter to cause the controversies to wake up the minds of the people. I tell you, I've seen some things in my life, and listen to Mother Rabbi speak here right now. Can you give me a minute? And I need to talk to people out here. Let me tell you something. Those same people that rode in my limo, parading all over town, from town to city to city. When my sales went down and I had to take the bus, you didn't see one of them volunteering to ride with me. I was on the bus like, what's her name? Miss Parks. I was at the back of the bus, y'all. And if some of them had it their way, I'd have been under the bus. You know what I'm saying? But they were glad and proud to ride around that limo. Oh, yes, eating up all that good food and getting all those snaps by the camera. I looked the same as I did now. I was a little bit younger. And teeth was probably a little bit better or not. Don't make no difference, though. But those same people. When it's time to take the bus, well, nobody there at the bus stop but me, you know. No more friends. I even seen someone ride by me in their car. Wouldn't even invite me, you know, in their car. So, that's the kind of friends I really don't need. And I'm talking to the singers out here, you two ladies, that you should be aware of the friends that start to, you know, congregate in your life. I had many friends that would just throw me into the water and watch me drown. And wouldn't save my life until after a crawl came around the bank side. Then they would save me. You know, just to be seen. That's some of your friends you have around here. You're just friends just to be seen. And you are to clear your life out of people that's just around you just to be seen or to take what you have. Those takers and no givers. You know what I'm saying? I always got some kind of sad story going on. Now, I'm a generous person, and I follow the Lord, please. When he said, do this, I do it. You know, no problem. It's not about the money. And that's a true statement, because all money belongs to God. But he also said that money is the answer to all things. Beware of the people in your life that never have none. Being that it's the answer to all things. Be careful. You don't ever have none, something is not right. As your soul prospers, so does everything else. So, you find people not equal enough, you are unequally up. Okay? That's just a lesson for Mother Rabbi. You know, some people are around you just to be UPS carriers. Carrying your business from one spot to the next, from one phone to the next. Stay away from UPS carriers. You know, working for the UPS and not getting paid. Just talking about you behind your back. Stay away from those. You don't need those kind of people, but always telling your business. And you take it, where'd you hear that from? I ain't told nobody that but one or two people, you know, your comforter. Be careful. Be so careful of UPS carriers. You shouldn't be around UPS carriers. If you don't know nothing about them, they should know nothing about you. Even if you know something about them, try to be as little as possible. Evasive people. Another one knows the word, girl. Evasive. Don't share so much. Tell it to the good Lord, you know. And you won't have no problems in the future, you know. Just, yeah, keep your mouth, keep the trap shut. My mother used to tell me, either you close your trap or I'll shut it for you. I shut my trap. Because I knew I had to sing a little bit later. And I didn't want my mom to track it because she would put her fist right on through that. That's probably what didn't happen to her teeth right now. Few of those fists got through. Few of those teeth got loose. That's all I'm saying. Some people will say nice doggy. Nice doggy. Until they get a rock in their hand to, you know, knock your head off. Be careful of those nice doggy friends. Because in the end, they're out to kill you or maim you somehow. Be careful of the nice doggy people. let me relieve one warning to all of you out there talking about me about this funeral thing. Never ever insult a mother alligator and me until I've crossed over the river. Keep that in mind. If you can't improve Mother Rybi, don't lie or abuse the elders. You know what I'm saying? That's all I'm saying. Be careful with what you say about Mother Rybi.
We have some great singing coming up, and don't you go anywhere. We have to go to our sponsors. That's the way we can keep our show going. And if you want to be a sponsor, all you have to do is subscribe and sponsor. Or you can just sponsor. Mother Rybi, we have talked in depth regarding your singers and singing, and we are so anxious to hear your song. And she is going to sing here on the show that song that she wrote for that funeral.
And I have a statement to make. I shouldn't make it, but I have a statement to make. This is to Missionary Titlittle. Missionary Titlittle, you lied on me. And I'm hoping that the ladies here let us both come on the show one day, because we're going to have to straighten that lie out. I won't get into it because it's not fair on her behalf, but Sister Titlittle, you know who I'm talking about, and I want to see you on the show. And I hear you coming up on the show soon, and I'm hoping I have at least a piece of that show to confront you about that lie that you told on me. That's all I'm saying. I've totally enjoyed this moment in time. I'll be like to leave me and be able to share my thoughts with others, many others, and I would like to talk to Mrs. Titlow. She hasn't been returning my phone calls, and Missionary Titlow has told a lie, and I want to confront Mrs. Titlow about this lie, and I'd like to discuss those lies before I leave the earth, you know, get it all straightened out. I didn't think this day was coming. It took so long, you know, it's been almost a year since I spoke to you on the phone. I really expected to be here a little bit sooner than now, and I forgive you, though. Uh-huh. Yes, I do. Yes, thank you so much for having me. Yeah, I think I'm going to get up now.
West Michigan Has Gospel 2 is brought to you by J.C. Penney's When It Fits, You Fill It, and by Macy's, It Brings Out the Star in You, and June's Funeral Home, where your family comes first.
Go! Rybi.